We will talk about higher level numbers. Yeah. So please, yeah.
Okay, sir. First of all, that I'd like to thank very much the organizer for the invitation. Yeah. So my talk is about higher level numbers, so it's not really about complex dynamics or about standard curvature. But I still hope that you enjoy the talk here, because somehow it's still quite related to complex dynamics. Yeah. Okay. So first of all, I will very quickly use what the numbers are and some of its basic properties. We work on a domain on an open subset omega in CN, and an upper semi continuous function phi from omega to R. Is called the Bruzzi subharmonics. If that function is not minus infinity, and in any complex line L, the function is a subharmonic or equal to minus infinity. So that notion is important in complex algebraic geometry and also in complex dynamics, and. In many of applications, it is crucial to understand the singularities of the Bruzzi subharmonic function. Yeah. So now let me recall you the notion of null numbers, which is the most basic notion measuring the singularities of a BSS function. Yeah. So we pick a point H in our domain omega, and R is a positive constant. And we consider that's average, make M phi here, given by the average of phi over the sphere of the ball center at X and of radius R, and we normalize the average by the volume of the sphere. And by the basis of the Bruzzi potential theories, we know that this function here as a function in the logarithmics of R, this is a convex and increasing function. And so that we can define that limit you see here, the quotient of which M phi and the logarithmic of R, and the limit is verified and give you the that number mu here. We call the little number of phi at the point X. There are several ways to interpret that numbers. Here is an easy way. We can view that little number of mu phi x as a largest constant lambda, satisfy that inequality you see in the slide. Phi is x prime less than the lambda times the logarithmic of x prime minus x plus this constant. Yeah. I try to use my pencil, but I don't see how to use it in the room. Normally, I can use this. But anyways, I was give up. Okay. So now, sir, let me give you the very basic examples. So any bounded Bayesian function has zero order numbers everywhere. So this is easy to see from the definition you see in the slide. But the converse is not true. By the user consider the function is a slide given by the minus of a square of minus log h, and this function is a BHS and has zero little numbers everywhere. Okay, now we come up with some problems about little numbers, and I'll show you what kind of question we want to understand and with these numbers here. Okay. So to formulate the question, we have to introduce some more notation, we always consider the point, the origins in omega. So this is just for simplicity. We look at things around the origin. Yeah. And we are interested in the similarities of Pearson's function near the origin. And we consider now the F1s, FMs, they are holomorphic function in omega. And now the C, alpha 1, alpha m, so they are positive constant. So we consider the function phi 0 given by the by that sum here, the sum of the modules of fj power alpha j. And if a function, sorry, this is a typo, if a function use different from phi zeros by bounded terms, then that function is called to have analytic singularities near zeros. So so our problems here, the main problems concerning this kind of object is that we want to understand how far a general zero Pearson function is different from the function with analytic singularities. So to motivate that kind of problems, I will recall you a crucial result due to the Mai. You can see in slide the statement. Because the phi, again, an arbitrary Pearson function, and for subfunction phi, there exists a sequence of Pearson function phi m with analytic singularities, such that phi m is bounded from below by phi, and phi m converges to phi in the M1 log topology. And moreover, the random numbers of phi m tend to those of phi as m tend to infinity for any point x. That's a theorem tell us that we can approximate the random numbers of an arbitrary Pearson function by using those with analytic similarities and from below by our original function. Yeah. So here's I just give some remark. This result of the Mayes event is very strong. It implies the famous theorem by Siu, stating that the upper sub level of the numbers is analytic. And moreover, I also want to give you a deleted result due to Homander, but it's weaker than that of the Mayi, but still it gives you some more information. Yeah. So because the now omega is a pseudo convex, bounded pseudo convex, and that result says that for every Pearson function on omega, this function can be approximated in L1 log by the function of the form by only the form logarithmic of f. So it's some kind of a divisor zeros Pearson function here. But anyways, this result doesn't give us any information about the approximation of the numbers. But the main important point here is that it gives us an intuition that we can approximate an arbitrary Pearson function by using the analytic object. So that is the motivation why we want to answer the problems in that slide here. The main problems in the talk. In the next slide, I give you some more precise formulation because the statement itself is quite vague. So we need a more precise object to measure, yeah, to play with. Okay. So now is the object we need to introduce. So we have learned about the numbers. Now we have a new object which are called higher order numbers. So the object also measure similarities of a PSS function, and I think they give refined information on the similarities than the numbers itself. To define them, we need some more technical tools, which I recall here. So first of all, just to make the presentation more simple, we consider only the basic functions which are locally bounded outside zero. So these functions are enough for our talk. You can think of some examples. As I mentioned here, the maximum of log x and w, here w is an arbitrary bounded Bayesian function. So that gives us enough, a good enough class of Bayesian function which are bounded outside the zone, locally bounded outside the zone. And I recall here that the operators DDC given by I over pi DD bar, okay? So now to define the higher order numbers, we need to talk about the motion pair operators. So these operators is a central notion in the Fujiwara tensor theory. So here we have a phi, you go here phi one and phi k, they are Bayesian function which are locally bounded outside zero. And so if they are smooth, then you can always wash the smooth forms with each other. But in our setting, they are no longer smooth, but usually they don't even continuous. And so to make sense that operators, we need to use some different ways to define it. Yeah. So here is the most common way to define the wash product of this DDC. Then we can define it inductively as you see in the slide, because I cannot use my pencil, so it's not easy to me to show greatly what I point out in the slide. But anyways, I hope you can still follow me. So here, in the end, we can define the wash product by using that formula you see in the slide. So this kind of operators has a long history. So I cite here some of the names of the main contributors to that operators. So you can think of the intersection of hypersurfaces as an example, yeah. Proper intersection. Yeah. And now we are ready to define our higher Lenoir numbers. Yeah. So we consider k is a number between 1 and n. Here, n is the dimension of our space. Then that's a small e k phi here. That's the higher order number of order k defined by this integral. So in that integral, you see here, the integrand is a measure because it's a wash product of maximal order, so it give you a measure. And now we measure the mass of that measure at the origin. And so we obtain a gradient of numbers E1, E2, until EN. So how the numbers are related to the numbers? So the first remark is the one you see right in the slide. If you use the long Bayesian numbers, you will see that the first numbers in the list actually equal to the long numbers of alpha and phi. So the whole collection, yeah, EK, number EK, give us a more refined information about the similarities of phi than only the long numbers. And now I give you a list of some of properties of these numbers because they are our main object in the talk, and I want you to have some kind of quick intuition about that object. So here are some list of properties and some kind of example, some quick example. Firstly, if you compute higher order numbers of function log x, then they are all equal one because of the basic computation you see in this line. And moreover, if the more singular our function is, the bigger our the numbers is, the bigger our higher number is. Okay. And if two basic functions are of the same singular type, then their higher numbers are equal. So this is a basic observation about these numbers. And I have some more in the next slide. So these numbers satisfy some very nice inequalities you see in the blue color in the slide. So that's that collection of numbers enjoy certain kind of log convexity properties. And in a particular, we deduce that if the numbers equal one are equal to zero, the first one is the least e1 equal to zero, then we have ek phi equal to zero for any k from 1 to n minus 1. So here's I emphasize that we don't have any information about en. Well, this is what we want to talk about in the moment here. Now we introduce a new class of function associated to phi. Basic a phi is a set of basic function p psi less singular than function phi. And p psi has analytic singularities. So here is a problem we want to study. So I divide it into two parts, but these two parts are closely related to each other. Maybe I talk about the second one first because historically the second one came first. So this one, this second statement here is work conjecture by Raskowski and Vietch, independently, I suppose. This they could say that if the little numbers of phi equals zero, then the last higher order numbers must be equal to zero as well. So as you see here in the first slide, I'm really sorry because I cannot use my pencil. So okay, never mind. So motivated by that second statement here, the mind is formulated something stronger. So he asks that originally his statement is a bit different, but basically it's equivalent to what I write here. He asks that whether we have that equality in that problem. That equality is means that whether the higher order numbers of phi can be approximated by those of basic function bounded from below by phi and having analytic singularities. So here's some works related to that problems. So it's well known. This well known that they are okay. They are these collectors are true if phi has analytic similarities or phi iteration by the work of people you see in the slide. Moreover, just some months ago, Chiles gave an example, a counter example to the conjecture of the Mai. So we have a negative answer to the first quadrature, but the second quadrature still remain open. Yeah. So the main goal of the talk is talk about the result of Qili and also about the resolution of his quadrature related to the examples. Yeah. I will show you now the statement now. Yeah. Okay. So here's some more notation. Yeah. Because we now talk about something a bit more specific. We consider P n minus one is a complex positive space of dimension n minus one, and omega n minus one is a fully Schwarz form on the P n minus one, and we consider U is an omega Bessel function on P power n minus one, and now we have a natural projection from Cn minus zero to Pn minus one. This we pull back U by that projection, and we obtain that we consider that function phi. You see in slide here is a maximum of two log x plus log x plus pi phi star U. So this give you a function, a Bessel function defined in, locally around zero, the origin in Cn, and that function is more similar than log x. And so here's what Qili's conjecture. His conjecture just the En of phi. The last higher little numbers in the list equal one if and only if U is of a full motion pair mass. So I will explain after what does notion mean, that full motion pair mass. But is a moment you should accept that notion. Yeah, so it could be more clear in the next slide. So now I will explain why that kind of statement is interesting. So so firstly, Qili's confirms this quadrature for a particular class of function U with zero alone the numbers everywhere, and also says in his class U is not of a motion pair mass, not of full motion pair mass, and. So because of that's a conjecture in his particular class, the last higher order numbers is strictly bigger than one. So so here's an interesting thing. If you look at the multiplier's ideal sieve of phi and that of log z, so it should be log z log x anyway. So it can prove that they are the same, and if you look at the sequence of Pearson function having energy singularities given by the result of the MyE, I recall it in the beginning, then you can see that that sequence phi m has the higher order numbers equal to one. 10 to 1. So that class given by Qili's give a couple of examples to the quadrature of the MyE. Our function has a function phi has a higher order numbers bigger than 1, but all of the function having analytic singularities but below by phi. Has a higher order numbers a small one, so this proves the main conjecture. But anyways, here's the main part. The argument of Qili's work but not for, for all the U, but only for a particular class of U. And that's why he considered that it should hold for any U, for any U the omega basis in a PM, PM minus one. And however, his argument and thing is don't work in that general setting because he used classical intersection of a close positive along current. And to be able to use that that classical intersection, we need to have some restriction on the, our function. So our main result in the talk is to confirm this condition in the full generality. Okay. So I have some more remark before we announce the main result. So in a moment we don't omit the facts I write in the slide, and I will come back to it in the next slide. So first of all the list of the collection of higher order numbers satisfies this condition, these properties. They are increasing for our choice of person five, and now we have some kind of some similar object, which also measure singularities of person U, but they are not higher order numbers, but something similar. You can think of it as kind of a global version of higher order numbers. Yeah. So it given by the one minus this integral you see here. So it should be clear to use in a moment that this number is positive, non-negative, and also increasing and between one and between the zero and one. So here's our main result with a no. Yeah. We claim that there is a constant C independent of U, such that we have this inequality between higher order numbers of phi and global version of higher numbers of U. If you look at that inequalities for a special case when k equal to n, then here you have e to the n minus 1, and here you have en, and here you have e to the n minus 1. So it's confirmed in a particular that if the en phi equal 1, then we must have e to the n minus 1 is equal to 0. So it's a implies a CD collector. Yeah. Now I will tell you some consequences of this statement. Okay. So now we have to restrict the class of a function U. So because the U has zero learner numbers everywhere, and the DDC U has a mass on some principal set in a P M minus one. Then what we have is the following. The higher order numbers of phi is strictly larger than the those of any Pearson function having an identity and less singular than phi. This is the meaning of that inequality. And one more remark about the assumption we made. We can construct plenty of function U satisfying the hypothesis. So that means we have plenty of examples Pearson function phi, so that we cannot approximate higher numbers of that function by those of Pearson function with analytic similarities. So this statement, I think itself has some philosophy's meaning, because it tells us that from the k equal to E2. So now we have this E1, E2 to EN. E1 is a little numbers and E2 to EN. They are higher little numbers. So from E2, you cannot recover the higher little numbers by using the object analytics associated to our function. So I think it gives us a new intuition about higher little numbers. Yeah. Because because before we still expect the data, we can recover the higher numbers by using the analytic objects, but now we know that we cannot do it. Yeah. I have some more remarks in the end of the slide, but I think it's not very important. So we can construct by using that result. We can construct a business function whose multiplier I and shift is the same as that of log z, but their higher order numbers are different. So this is also another observation. Now I talk about the object. The object here, EKT, which I have ignored in this last slide. So in order to talk about the object, we need to have some preparation about non-pluripolar product. So this is some kind of a motion vector operator, but for unbounded function, unbounded BSF function. The whole procedure to define is a bit technical, but at least let me try to give you some insights here. So because the E1 UAM is a BSF function on our domain OBI, and we want to make sure the intersection of DC E1, DC UAM. And here is a crucial observation by Bedford et al. That the kernel you see here, so in that subset, you say that bigger than minus k, they are actually equal. So if that sequence Rk is of mass uniformly bounded in k, then that sequence emit a limit, and that limit can be proved to be closed, to be a closed current. And so you obtain a closed positive current. And more importantly, if you look at the compact setting on a compact Gallium manifold with current T1, TM, they are global current on a global one current on our compact Gallium manifold, then that local procedure here can be glued together to obtain a global closed positive current, and that current is called the non-pluripolar product of T1 and TM. And here's some important remark about that object. The first is that non-pluripolar product, it has no mass on any the pluripolar set, as you see from its name, it has no mass. For example, if you take a T1 TM equal to current of iteration along the hypersurfaces, then you can compute that product equals zero. And secondly, here's the crucial properties of that product. Usually so with if you look back the classical intersection of closed positive on one current is a compact setting. You will see that that product preserve the mass preserve the cohomology class, but in the case of non-period product, this is no longer the case. The reason is that inequality you see in the slide. The last one is the slide. If you look at the mass of the non-period product, then it's in general less than the mass of the product of the class. So so this is the thing with a non-period product. Now we come back to that global version of higher level numbers. Yeah. Okay. So sorry, we have something more to something more precise to go through. Still, we are being in a compact Kalian manifold actually. And now we have some more current Tz prime. They are again close positive around current in the same cohomology class as Tz, and Tz prime is less similar than Tz. And now we have some much more stronger properties than that I announced in the last line. That here, if you look at the cohomology class of that non-period product, that this class is less than that of T1 prime versus Tn prime. So so here let me record that notion inequality here. So that means the difference between this class and this class can be represented by a close positive current. Okay, so now we can come back with E theta K. We come back with alpha and U's in P n minus one, and before we have defined that object, that number is E theta K given by one minus the integrals of that non-preprodu product here. So one is simply means we take integral over P n minus K minus one of the Fubini's 2D form, power S minus one. And now, thanks to that monotonicity of a non-preprodu product, now you know why we have the increasing sequence of the global version of higher order numbers. Let me record here what we want to do so far. We have pi is a projection from Cn minus zero to Pn minus one, and we have a phi even by maximum of that true function. And we want to compute the higher order numbers of that function. So now I will explain briefly how to compute this number. The whole proof is a bit technical, but we can divide it in some steps. I will show you now. So firstly, we want to take up a global product view. So originally, our problem is local because it's only around the origin. Then we want to look at it from a global point of view, and moreover, we want to transfer everything in the language of a non-preprodu product. So this step is not difficult. It's more or less a standard argument in a Purge potential theories, but you don't have to read the whole slide because you know the whole thing is that in the end we can represent our higher order numbers by a certain kind of by the mass of certain kind of non-preprodu product. And now to compute that mass, we use again, another kind of also well-known argument here. We blow up our space at the origin to obtain a bigger space, but which easier to handle with. This is what we do in the step two. We block our space, and here I change a bit the notation here. I put E equal to CM. That's our space. And if we block our space, we obtain a E hat. And we take V hat is the exceptional hyperspace. So that V hat is just simply can be identified to a P M-1, the complex projective space of dimension S-1. So here is the most important thing about that structure. We can define a natural position P hat from that block E hat to the exceptional hyperspace V hat. The construction is simple, but the observation is important here. I will show you the picture in the next slide. So here's our CM, okay, in the left hand side, the CM and its block is E hat. And in the right hand side, we have V hat, the exceptional hypersurface, which is isomorphic to P minus P, the complex projective space of dimension M-1. And in the lower part of the diagram, we have a pi, our position from CM minus zero to pi N minus one. Okay, so the whole thing is, so why that conjunction is useful? I will explain now. This is because we have that map P hat. This is actually a vector bundle map between E hat and V hat. So in the upper space, we have a nice structure. So that explains why it's easier to handle than the lower part. In the lower part, we have only a projection from a pi from CM minus zero to PN. So this is not nice because pi is singular at zero. It makes it difficult to work with. Yeah. And so now let's imagine we lift everything to our block E hat. And now we work on E hat instead of on CM. This is the idea. And as a key field, very quickly is how that monotonicity involved in the proof. So in the answer, we have to compute some kind of mass of some non-polar current on E hat. And to compute, not compute, but we need to estimate. So to estimate that mass, we will look at the potential of that current. And the potential of that current can be related to our original function U by that inequality here. I have to sorry again because I cannot use my pencil. So that inequality allows us to use monotonicity, the properties of a non-polar product to estimate our higher order numbers. And finally, we need another ingredient due to Brocky. So that formula is the last one you see in slide here. That formula allow us to compute the motion pair of maximum of two functions by something simpler than to compute here. Yeah. And I think this is all of the thing I want to tell you. And I stop here. And thank you very much for the attention.
Thank you, Peter. Very interesting topic. So